Okay. So enemies, the enemies of perfume. What are the enemies of perfume? What damages perfume? Okay, let's take it one by one. What was one? Heat. So temperature. Light.
Poor materials.
Poor raw materials is more to do with like the starting point, but I'm thinking once we've got it, yeah, what's going to damage it? What's going to cause us problems?
The base of the product.
Base of the product. I'll come on to that this afternoon when we talk about our product applications. Yeah.
Packaging.
Really, I'm talking about the perfume compound. What's going to... Poor packaging, yeah, packaging. And another one that I heard somebody say was oxygen. Anything else?
Temperature.
Temperature is this one here. Anything else? Keeping a cool. Clue is, oh, did somebody say moisture?
Oh,
humidity. Okay, okay, moisture. Okay. Yeah, I mean moisture, humidity, I think. Same thing, okay. Anything else? What's the worst enemy of perfume? Sorry?
Time?
Well, yeah, time is an important one. It's not the one I'm thinking of, though. Sorry?
Virus.
Viruses?
fortunately
for us, bacteria and viruses, etc., for perfume compounds are not such a problem, because almost nothing can live in a concentrated perfume compound. Yeah? So that's good. That's good news. It makes our manufacture a little bit easier. Yeah? What else? Yeah, other compounds, contamination. What's the biggest source of contamination?
Some other perfume compound around it.
Yeah, other perfume compounds around it. Bigger than that.
Storage.
Well, storage is the total subject. Yes, you.
About humans.
Humans, yeah, human beings, yeah. That's the biggest source of problems with perfumes. Okay, so what can we do about the problem with heat? How do we store perfume compounds? What temperature should we store them at? Yeah, maybe a bit cooler.
10 degrees.
Yeah, 10 degrees is about the optimum for storage of perfume materials. Problem is, like in this area, it's actually difficult to store something at 10 degrees. Actually, what's more important than the temperature is something else. A stable temperature, yeah? And I'll come on a bit when we talk about oxygen, why that's so important. In the UK, 10 degrees is a nice temperature to keep raw materials. Not too many materials go solid if they're already liquid. They decay fairly slowly at that temperature. If you go much cooler than that, then things like benzyl salicylate, benzyl benzoate will sometimes go solid, and then it's like a real pain to melt them back down, especially if they're in 200 kilo drums. Yeah. There's another thing with the temperature is if we kept things at 10 degrees centigrade in Thailand, can anybody see what the problem might be when you went to use them? There'd be a drastic temperature change between the cool room and the production room. Yeah? What would happen? What happens to cold things? What's happened to your bottle?
It starts to sweat.
You've got condensation, yeah? So as soon as you get a drum that's really cool and you move it out into a warm room, there's condensation on the drum. Then as soon as you open the cap, the liquid is cool too. Yeah? Oh, sorry. Okay. Sorry? Well, in terms of diffusion, but what we're looking at is storage, so that's not a problem for us at the moment, yeah? So we store at 10 degrees centigrade, we roll it out, yeah, we get condensation on the tank. Then we then open the cap, whether it's a bottle, a 10 gram bottle, or a 200 kilo drum, yeah? What happens? No. I mean, perhaps, but yeah? The condensation, what happens with the condensation? The liquid inside is cool. Because it's been kept cool, there's a negative pressure on the drum, and it sucks air in. The air has humidity. What happens to the moisture in the air?
Condensation,
actually on the liquid itself, actually on the raw material itself. So if you open this drum 20 times, yeah, each time you open it, you have more liquid, yeah? So one way that we can prevent this problem with the liquid condensing on the perfume is to make sure we have no more than a 10 degree centigrade change between the production area and the storage room, yeah? So practically for Thailand, we tend to keep things more in the range of 15 to 20 degrees centigrade, yeah? Because the temperature in the production room is going to be warmer than 20, yeah? 20, 25, yeah. Yeah. In the UK, yeah, where it's fairly cool, or New Zealand, yeah, it's going to be not such a problem. Light. What do we do about light? What's the problem with light?
Direct light could destroy your volatile oils.
Yeah, why? Why does light destroy?
Because it'll heat up the molecules. I'm just guessing. It'll heat up the molecules and, you know, they'll start to bump into each other and might get destroyed.
Yeah, it does the same thing as temperature, but not through heat.
But
I'll come on to that. So the first thing it does is cause agitation of the molecules. The photons hitting the molecules causes them to move faster. So any reactions that are going to happen will happen more quickly. The same as if we raise temperature, yeah? Any reactions that will happen between air and the liquid, materials in the liquid, will happen much quicker. So light agitates those. But you've noticed, we've spoken about this before, about some materials change color with light. Indol, yeah?
Citrus.
Citrus oils, yeah? The reason that white flowers go brown around the edges is due to what material in the petals? Anybody remember? Indol, yeah? Indol, yeah? That one of those materials in the N group, yeah, the narcotic group. So what can we do to prevent damage from light?
Store in dark places.
Store in dark places, yeah. Store in dark
drums.
Dark drums, opaque drums, or in brown coloured glass. Some people think that violet coloured glass is better. Some like blue glass. Yeah, take your choice. Yeah, but essentially, yeah, avoid light. Don't keep in bright sunlight. What else can we do about light? Anything else we can do to prevent damage from light? Prevent or slow down?
Just a quick question. When we're talking about light, we're talking about only the direct sunlight or?
Basically any light, but direct sunlight is much worse because it's far more active in terms of UV, yeah. UVA and UVB, yeah. And I think UVA is actually the most damaging. Yes.
In Thailand, the weather is hot, right?
Yes.
So if you have a room for the perfume, is it possible you will put your own box, like you know, on the wall?
Yeah. So certainly, if you're making a cool room and you're keeping it cool 24 hours a day, yeah. Particularly if one of those walls on the cool room face the sun, yeah, you have to fight the temperature of that sun. So it's a good idea to insulate the walls. And there's another reason for insulating the walls, particularly in Thailand, because if you're in a room in a building, yeah, and those walls get cool all the time, what happens to the outside walls? Condensation, they get fungus on them, and they look really awful after a short time. And if they're internal walls, then it's a potential health problem too. Yeah. So insulating walls is a good idea. But simple foam does it, although it's not. You really want fire retardant foam. Yeah. What else can we do to slow down the action of light on the perfume compound? Anybody think? Sorry?
BHT?
Yeah, so particularly for that one, particularly for light, what might we use? A UV absorber?
Yes.
Yeah? Something like benzophenone?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Benzophenone.
Yeah. And if we add this at the rate of about 0.1%, that's the standard sort of level for adding to slow down the action.
Sunblock
for perfume, yeah. And actually, some of the materials we use actually act as a sunblock. Salicylates and cinnamates are very effective for this. So if you actually have benzyl salicylate and something like methyl cinnamate in a compound, it will help to absorb UV light, so it slows down the action. DPG is a really successful thing for preserving compounds because it increases the viscosity of the perfume compound. Yeah. Somebody from Thermalink told me this with talcum powders.
Yes.
Thermalink found that if they took their perfume compounds for talcum powders and dissolved them 50% in DPG, they would last a lot longer in the end product because it would increase the viscosity and slow down the oxidation of the perfume.
But isn't DPG considered as an adulterant?
Well, it's a solvent, and it's a common solvent. But it's what's the definition of a solvent and an adulterant? Yeah, depends on what you tell the customer. if you tell them this is pure natural lavender oil, yeah, and it has 10% DPG in there, yeah,
it's an adulteration.
If you tell them it's lavender oil, 50% in DPG, then it's a solvent. Yeah? So, yeah.
And DPG is not flammable?
DPG, not very. It's hard to get to set a light. Yeah.
Is that the one that we could use in, like, diffuser? The room diffuser?
Yeah, the DPG tends to be a little bit too slow at evaporating to be used in a room diffuser. So usually you need something a bit more.
Just write a little bit bigger than
people. Yeah, can do. Is it these two words?
Yeah.
Yeah. I think think the best one. It's called benzophenone 3 for this, and BHT. More often it's added to the finished fragrance because we tend to control the light by using a dark place, yeah, opaque containers, yeah.
Doesn't it react with your compound? Is
there no reaction? There's definitely effect on the smell, but it's so minute at this level, yeah, that it's not normally regarded as a problem. Okay, so damage from oxygen in air.
It would react with a compound and make an absolutely new compound.
Yeah, so one of the things that what happens with terpenes, for example, in orange oil and lemon oil, yeah, it's the same thing that happens with rubber when it comes out of the tree and hits the air. What happens to it? It becomes sticky, yeah, because it polymerizes the molecules. Yeah, stick together and they form a bigger molecules, yeah? And the production of benzoin from a tree is from the terpenes coming out of the tree trunk. They hit the air and the molecule starts to stick together and form this resin.
Is that the same thing that happens with blood?
Pass. no, I think it's a bit more complex with blood. So if we want to prevent oxidation, yeah, Francois suggested one method, BHT, which is butylated hydroxy toluene. And there's another one available, which is slightly better for food, which is butylated hydroxy anisole. I don't like it as much as BHT in terms of effectiveness. Both of these are antioxidants, used at about 0.1% on average. But there is an interesting thing that Francois said about colour change for effect of light. Indole, if you put into a compound at 0.1%, 0.5% for a jasmine, to give a really nice jasmine, you really need that sort of level of indole. It will change the perfume to bright red within about 6 months, dark brown within a year to 2 years. Yeah. If you add an equal amount of BHT to the amount of indole you have, it tends to slow that action down. It doesn't stop it completely, it just slows it down, makes it a little less obvious. Yeah. And for your end product, that might be a problem. Yeah. So incorporation of BHT when you have indole in a perfume is a good idea. Yeah. Yeah, vitamin E is another one that's used sometimes. Vitamin E is not so efficient, yeah? So whereas you're using 0.1% here, you'd have to use about 1%, yeah, to get the effect. And it's not as effective. It's not as effective. But if you want a natural alternative, yeah? There's also another interesting for me, antioxidant. Who buys olive oil sometimes? And have you ever bought it with a stick in it? Stick of rosemary in the, yeah? That stick of rosemary in there acts as an antioxidant.
And then adding rosemary would affect your fragrance.
Yes, yeah. But there is a company in Germany, Flavex, that do an extract of the antioxidant properties of rosemary that you can use in a compound, yeah?
Then you could also add green tea.
green tea. I don't know. I'm not. I'm not sure. Yeah, it's an antioxidant for the body, but I'm not sure if it would be an antioxidant for a compound. But the Flavex materials, the rosemary extracts, are quite effective. Again, they're used at the level of about 0.1%. And we stock those if you're interested. Yeah. And in fact, we stock all four of these. Yeah. So that's vitamin E. Yes, yeah, that start of that. The only disadvantage with the rosemary antioxidant is it's a very dark colour, dark green. Very slight. Not to the point that it's a problem with the compound.
And the vitamin E,
the same level? I mean, I would, to be honest, with the Flavex, I would tend to use like a little bit more than 0.1, but it is effective from 0.1, yeah.
What's the maximum that you can add of these antioxidants?
Essentially as much as will dissolve. They're not irritant, they're not.
You have new ones now, you have Corabsorb, the one with this type of blends of antioxidant.
And, yes.
They have many different agents, so it's usually a blend of two, three, or four of them.
Yes. So blending them can improve the properties and give you a better, yeah. Ciba Geigy have one they call Tinto Guard.
Yes, okay.
Yeah. Yeah, Heliovisor, Heliopan, or.
But none are very efficient.
No, I did tests with a Tinto Guard because they recommend this for colour changes, and to be honest, it wasn't any more effective than BHT, and it's four or five times the price. So, Well, the Tinto Guard, I think, is water soluble, so that could be used for different applications. So, yeah. But there is something else that we need to do to prevent oxidation.
Make sure that your environment is oxygen-free.
You're correct. You're correct in a way. Yeah. But no oxygen. Yeah, no oxygen in the room. Yeah, we make a vacuum. Yeah, a bit of a problem for human beings, but the perfume's fine. You have to go in a space suit for to do the combination. Yes, I'm going to come on to it. Yeah. Okay. I'll do that immediately. Okay, so let's say we have a big drum. This applies to a... Yeah, and we have our perfume inside. That's all our perfume there. We can see through this drum, yeah. It's opaque, but we can see through it. So on the top we have an airspace, yeah. So one thing, we're actually not too worried about not being oxygen immediately around. What we're interested in there being no oxygen in contact with the liquid. So if we can push the oxygen out, yeah, using nitrogen as an example, yeah, then when we close the container, yeah, there is no oxygen to react with the liquid. Yeah. Is there a problem with nitrogen? No. Good. I'm going to come on to argon. Yes. That's right. Okay. So I'll come to argon in a minute. Yeah. It's good. It's nice. So nitrogen, what's the weakness with nitrogen?
It's reactive.
No. No, it's not particularly. It's fairly enough.
It hasn't got
no. No. No odorant. No. What's the main composition of air?
Nitrogen.
Yeah, 80% nitrogen. So what it means is that the density of the nitrogen in the tank is very close to the air. So it tends to mix and leak out very easily, yeah? So if we use a much heavier gas, such as argon, yeah? Argon is a noble gas, it means it's completely non-reactive, yeah? We can float the argon on top of the liquid. So the argon sort of sits on top of the liquid. When we open the container, yeah, it doesn't immediately rush out. Yeah? And in fact, you virtually all you need of argon is just like a 1cc of argon in that tank, because it will settle on the surface and stop the oxygen contacting the liquid. So argon is very efficient. The problem with argon is expensive, yeah. It's a lot more expensive, yeah. First company I worked for, Pico, we always used argon. Yeah, as the thing to float on top of the tanks before we close the tanks. Yeah. But there's still something actually that you can do to prevent oxidation. And it's the biggest problem by far. Anybody know what it might be?
Suck the air out.
Sorry?
Suck the air out of the drum?
No, because that would be like difficult to do. There's something much, much easier, and it's the biggest mistake companies make.
Mics.
Sorry?
Mics
no.
Is this
yeah.
Floating cap?
Sorry?
Floating cap, some material?
More complicated than argon, so yeah, not so practical, yeah?
Fill the drum up completely so there's no...
Right, well, one thing is to fill up the drum completely, keep the drums full. So, as a young assistant in the compounding room, you know, my job was to like refill the bottles after they're like half full. We'd put them into other bottles, yeah, dark glass bottles. But something more than that, more simple than this.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Stuff in the like foil bag, and then the valve allows
the
air to come out, but it won't allow air to come in.
Yeah. Theoretically possible. Mm. The problem with our materials is that they will eat the plastic that's used for lining the foil. Mm. Yeah. And so that wouldn't work, but we can do it for things like hydrosols, like distillation waters and things. Yeah.
They have to go in the tins.
Yeah. Yeah. Something even easier.
What about when you're doing the drum, you fill up all your bottles from that drum in one go?
Yeah, you could do that. So if you normally use 10 kilos at a time, but it's a lot of work. Perfumers are lazy. Yeah. There might be spillage, but you're going to get that anyway. Yeah.
No, I'm not thinking, like Kushan mentioned, that you could fill up the drums completely.
Yes. Well, only in terms of if the temperature is going to change drastically, you want something so that the drum doesn't actually explode. When you go back and do your experiments at home, you know, if you get a material that's solid or it's gone solid and you heat it up, make sure you release the cap slightly, yeah, because the bottle may, yeah, and it hits the boiling water and then your whole house smells of the material, let alone if it's like got glass in your eye. Yeah. Vacuum. It's too complicated. You can use the argon. Give up? Okay. Close the containers tightly. I tell you what. No, it's not a given. It's not a given, and it's the biggest mistake they do in production. Yeah? So, do you remember this thing with heat, what I said about stable temperature? Okay, big drum, container, yeah? The seal on the rubber seal that's around this cap is a little bit eaten away by the materials. Tighten up the top, it's not 100%, yeah? What happens when you roll it out onto the floor of the production area? It's cold, into the warm area, what happens? Expands, the air is pushed out. You roll it back into the storeroom, the air gets cool, what happens? Fresh oxygen, yeah? And even in the cool room, the temperature is going to be changing 1 or 2 degrees centigrade, yeah? So that tank is fresh oxygen all the time, the tank's breathing, yeah? And actually, even without the argon, even without the nitrogen, even without the BHT, yeah, the vitamin E, yeah, you'll save your materials far better if you just close the containers tightly, yeah? And it is, so many materials are spoilt, yeah, because of this.
But just yeah. The oxygen in there, isn't it?
Yeah, but when you get the oxygen and it stays in there, what happens? The material reacts with the oxygen in the tank, the oxygen is finished, all you have left is nitrogen, yeah? End of reaction, yeah? Close containers tightly, absolutely crucial. Yeah, and then, yeah, obviously, check the rubber seals, yeah.
What about those plastic seals that you use on your aluminium containers? Isn't that a better solution then, rather than rubber?
It's okay. No, they're okay. They're quite good, yeah, they're quite good. The ones with from the French,
rather use like
the French company. Yeah, that's it. To really tighten it, yeah, yeah, yeah. But if you have a bad seal, rubber seal inside, then even if you tighten it, actually you haven't really tightened it because there's like a little hole or there's a little a crease in the rubber, yeah? And so it's still able to breathe.
But these days the drums are, you know, usually aluminium and they're just like a screw thing.
So yeah, with a screw thing and if... No, but in bulk it's in steel drums, yeah? Or even plastic, maybe plastic HDPE drums.
Hey,
yeah.
Yep. With a plastic ring between, I tighten it really tightly, make sure it's clean, no leak.
Yes.
Put it in the cupboard, come back 2 weeks later, it's leaked. It's gone. Somehow it comes out and it goes around the outside. What time does that work? It climbs up and it goes back down again. Hygroscopic?
Probably changing temperature is partly forcing it, but oils do love to go around seals. It's really, particularly with fixed oils, even more than our perfumery materials, fixed oils and seals, yeah, really, really tough, yeah? I mean, I don't know how actually they achieve it with, you know, olive oil and things like that without leaking, because if you actually get a container in a normal lab and you're using fixed oils, once you've opened it once or twice, it's leaking. I mean, you can't do anything about it, you know? Yeah. To be expected, yeah. I'll jump over to moisture. What can we do to stop moisture? So we didn't close our containers properly. Yeah. It's been breathing. In addition to oxygen, it's also sucked in moisture. And now there's moisture mixed in with our oily perfume material, orange oil. The orange oil's gone cloudy. Yeah, anything we can do? Sorry?
Using a dehumidifier?
Using for the room, that would reduce it. And an air conditioner actually acts as a dehumidifier to some extent. Yeah. But we've now got a liquid that's a little bit cloudy. Anything we can do? Sorry?
Freeze it out?
I suppose actually that might work. Yeah, that would work. Yeah?
Yeah, but
That will work. But it's a big job, yeah?
You need it immediately, then you will unfreeze it.
Yeah.
And you apply heat, cold and heat.
Yeah.
Then you damage.
Wasting time, yeah. Anything, it's the same thing they do when they distill essential oils. When you distill essential oils, you've got an oil and water mix. And in the perfect world, yeah, you get a perfect separation of the oil and the water. In reality, you usually get a little bit of water in the oil. And to remove it, you use something that's anhydrous, a crystal that's anhydrous. That means a crystal that's missing a water molecule in the crystal. And so it will absorb water, yeah? One of the common ones to use is sodium sulfate. And what you do is, and I should add that word, anhydrous. You add about 1% of the sodium sulfate to the liquid, and you'll see almost immediately it will absorb the water. Because sodium sulfate is water soluble, it will fall to the bottom of your tank, and then you just need to filter out the liquid. Yeah.
So you add this every time you want to use a certain quantity of the oil, or
no.
Store it?
Only if you find you have a problem with your oil because it's gone cloudy because of a presence of oil.
The oil with this, right?
No. There's no need. Sorry? Overkill and unnecessary work, I would say. Yeah,
so
I don't think you could
only when there's a problem.
Only when there's a problem.
And that will clear up the solution.
Yeah.
But if you get the final quantity, the quality of the product.
Well, it will help to stop it decaying any further. So if it's been cloudy for a long time, so the presence of water in orange oil will cause the delimonene in the orange oil. It will increase the speed at which it polymerizes. And then in the bottom of the orange oil, you'll get like a waxy sort of mass, a gooey mass, yeah? And that will help to slow that process down.
Yeah. Does
that moisture make it polymerize as well? Well, it just helps the process, yeah? It helps the process for another reason, which I'll come on to in a minute, yeah? To do with packaging. About 1%, but as much as necessary, yeah. Sometimes it's just like a few grains, if it's like a 100 cc's or something, or a litre bottle, and you can see it clear,
so
you add a little
water
bit.
Would absorb into the crystals.
Yeah, the water goes into the crystals, and then falls out of solution. You just pour the liquid off the top, or if you want to get the last bit, filter it through
but
a filter paper.
Any of the other material?
No. It doesn't mean the powder will not smell of the orange oil or whatever at the end. There'll
be really over water.
Over water, yeah. Sorry?
What sort of micron filter would you need?
An O, a Wattman paper, zero, O. Yeah.
Well, what if the material is water soluble?
Sorry? Then you have, well, then you probably won't get cloudiness from the contamination of water. So not a problem. Yeah.
So that stuff is the equivalent of the silica gel?
Yeah, so it's a silica gel in air or, yeah. But you can, other things that will work, but we'll use these, I'll show you what we use these. Other anhydrous crystals would work, like anhydrous citric acid, anhydrous tartaric acid, yeah. But they have some other benefits, which I'll go on to. But just for moisture, sodium sulfate is probably the most common used. Time. So shelf life of raw materials. How long should we keep raw materials? How long should we keep perfumes? Yeah, thank you. So, how about citrus oils?
Short time,
yeah. Citrus oils, because of that delimonene thing, yeah, very susceptible to changes in color. And this is interesting, we did this in the video, like orange oil actually gets lighter and lighter with time, yeah? But tangerine oil does exactly the opposite, gets darker and darker with time, yeah? Because of the different components, yeah? So, I know if you, people would say that they recommend that you use citrus oil within 3 months. Not really practical, yeah? If you use citrus oils, many companies keep them in fridges, but there's a problem with that. 6 months to a year, ideally, for citrus oils, yeah? But it's important to keep them well. I have kept lime oil for 5 years, yeah? Not at our current company, at another company I used to work. Had it for over 5 years. But because the tank was tightly sealed, never a problem.
You're right. In fact, you can keep it until it's bad.
Yes.
And so it could be 3 months, it could be 3 years.
3 years, yes,
so
yes.
Again, you have to smell it, I believe.
Yes, yes, yeah. So the idea is after 6 months, not to throw it away, yeah?
Smell.
Expiry date, smell it, and see if it's okay, yeah? Yeah. Don't assume. Yeah.
If you open
yeah.
and close a container every day, then you're looking at 3 to 6 months. But if you open it once every 6 months, then.
Yeah.
But once again, it's the logic. You have no rule. The rule is smell. When it smells bad, it's bad. You throw it away.
I know why Francois said this, is because people get a bit crazy about the expiry date. Yeah. Everybody's crazy about expiry dates nowadays, yeah?
You see someone yeah. wine.
If you buy olive oil that's 10 years old and you open it and it doesn't smell rancid, you can use it, yeah? It's not a problem, yeah? It doesn't matter if it expired 5 years before,
yeah? You say that, it's just open it, give it a smell.
Give it a smell, yeah. Check it against your standard, yeah.
But if it's expired, it would go against your GMP, right?
Yes. So you sell it to somebody, they sell it back to you, and you get a new expiry date. Okay.
Yeah. All right, so Steve, your material's gone off. Now what are you doing? Throw it down in the rain? Dig a hole in the garden?
I'm going to ask the people from England for this one. Yeah, this is horrific. In Thailand, it's not a problem. In Thailand, it's not a problem. In the UK, Australia certainly. I'm not sure. I assume New Zealand's the same. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. I mean, it's so crazy in the UK that you have to pay somebody to clean your tanks before. Your old drums before you throw them away. Yeah? It's like, yeah. So the cost of recycling is like horrific. Yeah, I mean, you have to check with your local authority, your local regulations. Send them to Thailand, yeah.
Potpourri?
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, that's when, the end, you know, I said about keep your samples when you make perfumes, keep them for a year or so. And then before you throw them away, smell them because you might have a masterpiece in there.
I do packaging and done the labeling and stuff like that. Label them.
I'm not sure where you're going with that. So
the fact that you know when to throw them and stuff.
Oh, I see. Yes. Yeah. Yeah. No. So yeah. So you make samples like you made samples here. What I say to you is like smell them before you throw them away, because even though it wasn't what you intended on the day, it may be a masterpiece that you want to use for some future creation. But with those samples that you throw away, usually perfumery companies keep a mille fleurs or a potpourri tank, yeah? And it's probably like a 200 kilo drum, and somebody just pours the samples away in them before they throw the bottles away. Yeah, and then at the end of 5 years, you end up with five drums of, yeah, or more, yeah, of perfume that's spoiled, orange oil that's gone off, yeah, and you mix it all together, yeah, and you approach something like a incense stick maker or a potpourri flower maker and say, do you want to buy some cheap perfume? Yeah, but it's a one-off, yeah. And they call this mille fleurs, which is 1,000 flowers, or potpourri, like a general mix. And so, I mean, some of the big joystick manufacturers will buy 5 tons of this at a time sometimes. So it's, yeah. Sold as seen.
Is that why potpourri smells so horrible?
Yeah. Well, no. I mean, that if you look at like Marks and Spencers or something like that, yeah, you won't have a problem. Yeah. But if you look at maybe some more general brands, I don't want to go into any names. Or yeah. But they're giving us a service, you know? Because what would you do with that material otherwise?
Yeah.
Yeah?
Mm-hmm. But do they add new flavors in them?
They might blend them, yes.
Bring them out.
They might take your potpourri and then add some jasmine to it or something, or, yeah.
I think to get rid of a drum, a 200 kilo drum, it costs £150 in the UK.
Really? How much is the drum cost?
£20 or something, yeah. Wow. So if you can sell it for 50p a kilo, it's it's a bonus. You save £250, yeah. Yeah. Wow. It's amazing. So, okay, so we said citrus oils, yeah, 6 months. General materials, things like normal aroma chemicals, a year is a good number to start with, a year to 2 years, yeah. And then if you go to the woody oils, patchouli and vetiver, yeah, they shouldn't actually have an expiry date on them, yeah, because they actually get better the longer you keep them, yeah, if they're not adulterated oils, yeah. But if they're pure oils, they will get actually better and richer. Patchouli oil, vetiver oil after 3 or 4 years is intense. Yeah.
My feeling about labeling the bottles is I think you should put like they do with food products, a use by and a sell by date, not an expiry date.
Hmm. But then, there's usually another, please use within 3 months . But of course, things like patchouli and vetiver should actually have do not use before. Contamination. If you store indole and heliotropin close to each other, interesting things happen. They change colour. Yeah? The vapours from each affect each other. Strangely enough, even if you try and keep them really as tight as possible, you actually still get this effect. Quite interesting. Sorry? They change colour. They both change colour, yeah. It's probably like Siamese fighting fish, you know, they can see each other and they get agitated. Yeah. Now, the other thing is, of course, if you store your garlic oil next to your lemon oil, yeah, in no time at all. In fact, if you put garlic oil and lemon oil, for example, into a box, and you walk around the block, yeah, and then open the box, the lemon oil will smell of garlic. Yeah? Yeah. So that actually happens to some extent if you, for example, stored even two different smelling materials together. So if you store benzaldehyde, which smells of cherries or almonds, next to linalool, yeah, it is possible to get some contamination. So is there a way that we could reduce that? We have a system. Well, close tightly, obviously, that's like... Together, yeah. And that's where the ABCs is actually like a really good thing. So because if you store aldehydes with aldehydes, if you get a slight contamination of aldehyde C10 in aldehyde C9...
It makes it easier to find, do it?
Yes, yeah. Well, if you're doing by smell. I like it for the laboratory because when you're looking for a sandalwood smell as a perfumer, all your sandalwoods are together. And instead of thinking, oh, I want sandalwood, I need maybe Indisan, maybe santalol, maybe amaryllis oil, maybe, yeah, they're all in different places if they're stored alphabetically by the name. But if they're stored by the group, yeah, it's quite a good creative thing for looking at alternative smells. Yeah, oh, I've got all my sandalwoods are together, all my citrus notes are together, yeah, all my dairy notes are together, yeah. And it's quite a handy way to...
Yeah.
Are you thinking point of view of production or...
smell-wise, think back then all.
Yes.
Some people believe it's sandalwood, some other would say it's rosy.
Yes, yeah.
So where do you put it?
Well, is it primarily rose or is it primarily wood?
For me, it's rose.
Really? Okay. So in that case, yeah, in your ABCs, yeah, you would store it under rose, yeah. I mean, what did I say to you about the program? You change it to what you think, yeah, because, yeah. But generally, if you do that, you get similar things together, so you get less contamination, yeah. Packaging. If we go back 20 years, the big no-no in packaging was plastic. Yeah, don't use plastic at all. Yeah, it's actually changed now because the quality of plastics has got a lot better. Yeah, and nowadays you can actually store some materials in LDPE. HDPE. Yeah, containers. Other plastics that are not affected too much by perfume. High density polyethylene, yeah, which I think a lot of the containers are now.
Is there a weight issue with it?
PP, sorry?
Are they heavy?
No, they're very light. They're very light. That's the nice thing about them. And when you pick them up and you bang them against your leg, they don't hurt quite as badly as a steel container. Yeah. So they're actually nicer for handling. In some respects, yeah.
Are these fluorinated
ones? I don't know. Yeah, yeah.
Always ask for fluorinated
ones.
Containers.
Yeah, that's probably to make sure there's no free PE. Yeah, and that's probably why the quality is better now.
Yeah.
So PP, polypropylene. Yeah, these are the boxes. Food boxes, yeah, fairly impervious to perfume, but they do split, so they're not actually so good for a liquid container, yeah, but for solid powders, yeah, quite good. Sorry.
What are these little boxes?
Oh, this one.
Yeah.
Oh, these are PP. Yeah. But PP. And the other one that some people store materials in are the water bottles, PET. Actually not too bad, yeah? But they are brittle, they're not suitable for shipping, yeah? The only one really suitable for shipping is the HDPE, Plastics you must avoid, yeah? Polystyrene, big no-nos, yeah? Acrylic. PVC. Yeah, like orange oil will cause them to like shrink in.
Yeah.
And then there are other materials that make them go brittle. So they're not really suitable. So for long-term storage, what's the best material?
Glass.
Glass is the material. In fact, the very first company I worked for, Pico, yeah, all our mixing tanks, they were cast iron with glass lining.
Yeah,
yeah. Nowadays that would cost a fortune. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Really? Yeah, yeah.
Pico.
Sorry?
Is it an energy company?
No. Pico Laboratories. It was. Yeah. It was the last manufacturing perfumers in the UK. Did they actually manufactured and made their own perfumes, created them, bottled them, distributed them. And it was bought out by Beecham's, and then Beecham's looked at it, and £250,000 a year was not interesting. And they moved two perfumes to the Lonthric brand, Pagan and Pagan Man, and then dropped all the others. Death of a perfume house. Sorry? Okay, so glass is... Yeah, by far the best. But not practical for what reason? For shipping. Heavy, breaks. Iron or mild steel tanks. Or drums. They actually call the drums drums, and the little ones they call tails. Yeah. Don't know why, but yeah. So a drum really means a 200 kilo drum. Yeah, and a tail means 100 kilo, 50 kilo, 25 kilo, 10 kilo, 5 kilo. Mild steel drum. Yeah, in China they like to galvanize them, coat them in zinc, yeah. Which is cheaper. Why do you have to coat them in zinc? What's the problem?
Rust.
Yeah. And anybody know what the reaction, what happens with iron and perfume? Why? Iron acts as a oxygen magnet. Yeah, that's one thing, yeah. Sort of sucks oxygen in. With an oil like clove oil, cinnamon oil, vetiver, patchouli, yeah, the presence of iron, even if that iron comes from the distillation process, yeah, it makes the oil go black. Yeah. Now you can coat these tanks, yeah, galvanize. I think it's only from China I see the galvanized tanks. I can't remember seeing them from other places, yeah? Yeah. But in the West, in Malaysia, there's a big company called Van Leer, which do the drums and the tails. And they give you a choice of coating them with two coatings. One is a phenol coating, which is a light brown coating, which used to be the most popular, and I don't know why. Yeah, or an epoxy coating, which is like a creamy grey or a creamy brown, light brown colour. Yeah. For me, it costs like 50 cents extra for the epoxy coating, but it's per tank, but it's like 10 times better. Yeah. The phenol coating dissolves because, anybody can think why?
Dissolves.
Because? What, our materials? our phenols. We have phenols in our materials, so they're solvents for the lining. Yeah. So sometimes when you get one of these drums, if it's got something like it can happen with ceramic alcohols, a really bad one, phenol ether alcohol can do it. As you pour out the liquid, this horrible brown mass comes out, which was the lining of the tank. Yeah. Uh, 200 litre, which is the 45 gallon one, which if you go to America, they call it the 45 gallon tank. Then 100, then 50, 25, 10, 5. I think that's about it. You can also get some tins sometimes. You see tins occasionally, which are 1 or 2 kilos, slightly cheaper than the aluminiums. So the biggest problem here, as you say, is rust, contamination of the iron in the raw material. What could we do? This comes on to what do you do once something is spoiled? So you've bought your clove oil and it's black. Yeah? Anything we can do to remove the iron? Two basic methods. Yeah, very good. A chelating agent, yeah. And one of the chelating agents, and that's why I said about citric acid. Citric acid is a chelating agent, yeah. If you put citric acid into the black oil and you leave it usually about 7 days, yeah, you'll see that the oil lightens in color and you'll have this black crystal lying mass at the bottom, yeah. So it's closed around the iron molecule or atom and then dropped out and it lies at the bottom of the tank.
Chelating.
Chelating, yeah. Or chelating, CH.
Any citric acid?
Citric acid, you can use tartaric acid. Tartaric acid works. Another one that you can use is sodium EDTA. Yeah?
What is that?
Sodium EDTA. So maybe I should write these down. So you've got citric acid, citric, tartaric, there's also a tetrasodium EDTA which you can use, sodium EDTA, disodium EDTA. Sorry? Full as earth.
Yeah.
Oh, I've never tried that, so that's interesting. Yeah. Interesting. Don't. Okay.
It works pretty well, but time gives us
help. Okay. But it does work. Okay, so that's interesting. Yeah.
And how much do we put?
I would start at 1%. Yeah, start at 1%, and then see what happens. If generally speaking, if you get like a perfume that's changed really dark colour, but the smell's okay, and you think, what can you do? This is something you can try because it's a cheap way to see if you can recover it. If the problem is iron, yeah? And the iron might not be because it could come in a glass bottle and have the same problem because the iron may be from the distillation equipment, yeah? So it's an easy way to try it. Get some citric acid, drop it in, 1%, quick stir, leave it for a week. And if it doesn't change, iron is not the problem.
Yeah.
No. Yeah, it doesn't dissolve yet. It's water soluble, so it doesn't dissolve in your perfume. Yeah, the acid doesn't really affect it. Yeah.
Let's say you thought iron was the problem.
Yes.
And you added citric acid, but iron really wasn't the problem. Then it just stays in there.
So the another method that you can use to remove what may be a contamination of some sort is to redistill the material, yeah? Which for a perfume would probably destroy it, yeah? But if it's something like clove oil, maybe okay, yeah? And actually some people prefer to do that rather than add the citric acid. But it seems, you know, but if you're a distillation company, maybe it just seems easy to do, yeah? But if it's not your main business, it's, Yeah. It's a bit of a pain. Okay.
So you haven't mentioned aluminium.
Oh yeah. So last but not least, aluminium. Aluminium containers are increasingly popular because they're not generally reactive. There are some materials that they don't like, phenols. Yeah, they don't generally like phenols much. The other thing is, if you store materials in aluminium for a long time, they tend to take on a metallic smell. Yeah? And, sorry?
You lacquer the aluminium container.
So you can get lacquered aluminiums. That phenol lacquer, yeah, will be dissolved by some materials, yeah. So you get that same thing where, for example, cinnamic alcohol in a lacquer container, after you've melted it down, cinnamic alcohol goes solid. So after you've melted it down and used it a few times, you pour it out, and this horrible brown, slimy mass, which was the lining, flows out, yeah. So if you don't line them, most materials are okay, but as I say, they tend to take on a metallic note. You can remove a little bit of that metallic character if you use sodium EDTA, yeah? That can help to remove that metallic character.
Steel?
Yep.
Stainless steel is too expensive
for drums, but actually, having said that, I've worked with customers who have like regular orders for a particular compound in big amounts, and they've had steel drums specially made, but they have to be things that like they can refill and send back, wash, refill, send back, yeah. But too expensive for everyday shipping.
Option.
Cheap is plastic. again, depends where you are. Yeah, depends where you are. That's the, yeah.
Have to destroy it again.
Yeah. Yeah. It's like Europe is. Something else possibly, which is similar, like a glazed ceramic container is possible. Yeah. Sorry. Yes. That's right. Yes. But it's by far the best for the material. So it's. Yeah, but we keep some of the materials, you know, the nice some of the materials in glass, and yeah, if they break, then tears all around. Another material actually used to be used for shipping, but not nowadays. Copper. Yeah, when you used to buy. Rose Otto from, not, yeah, yeah. By Rose Otto from Bulgaria, it would come in a sealed copper, and you'd actually have to saw the top off to get to the rose oil. Yeah. Sandalwood used to come in, no, in sealed. Sandalwood used to get, yeah, in sealed. Yes, yeah, sealed. You had to saw them open to get the sandalwood out. Yeah. Sorry. Yeah. Okay, so that's, oh, and the last but not least, and the worst, no. Humans.
Just,
yes, please.
The last thing on the container, the iron or the steel, the problem also is if it's banged,
yes.
You break the lacquer or the lining inside most of the time.
Yes.
So this is why I think plastic is by far the best.
Yeah.
Except for 200 kilos.
Yes, yeah. Yeah, so Francois said that if you dent the container, like a steel container, it damages the lining inside, so then the iron contacts the material, then you get the problem about iron contamination. Yes. It's okay. Let me say why the actually these ones actually are really bad, is because plastics use a group of materials called plasticizers: diethyl phthalate, dimethyl phthalate, dioctyl phthalate, dibutyl phthalate. Any of those names familiar? One of those is a solvent that we actually use in perfumery. So, yeah, when you put diethyl phthalate into one of these containers, it basically just melts the plastic. Yeah. Okay. And what do we do about human contamination? Training. That's training, and try and build out in your area, build out problems. Sorry?
A lot of firing.
A lot of firing. No, training I think works best, because usually once somebody's made a mistake, yeah, they're much more coachable. Yeah? Once somebody makes a mistake, once somebody's spilt the Neroli oil. Yeah. Oh, Oris, sorry, Oris. I was thinking we did something similar. Somebody spilt Neroli oil, a kilo bottle, and it dropped on the floor and lost about 200 grams. Yeah. But after that, people become much more aware. Once they've done that, yeah, it's cost you a bit of money, but it's like money for training, basically. If they learn. Yeah, well, it is, I mean, yeah. You know, one of my best lessons, really, was after we do quality control, the older samples get, like, returned to the bulk. And one day I did a perfume sample. It was a 10-gram sample, and I put it into the wrong bottle. And we had to throw 5 kilos away of a perfume compound, you know? And that was like when I was 17, and it's like, it's stuck in my mind, you know, like, double read the bottle, you know? Always look, because you can make mistakes.